And I want to talk really forward this morning and in ways that I think that we need to be real, we need to be honest, and we need to be all in when it comes to what we want in this life, not just because of it's a new year, but what is a new year, a new beginning, changes that are going to last beyond 1 week when your resolutions are being challenged. And it's more than that. I realize people say, well, I don't do resolutions. We need to trust God for it right now. Absolutely. I'm with you on that. Let's not wait till January 1 to make some decisions. Let's make some decisions this morning. But I want to talk about this this notion that I see within Christianity and really permeating the church. It's cute Christianity versus committed Christianity. I have conversations with a lot of people, and I monitor what's happening around our communities. And, you know, you talk to people about, what do you believe in God for this year? And then they come up with something real cute like, well, I just want to love my kids more. Well, good for you. That's awesome, right? That's how challenging is that really? You know, I just want to have more money in my savings account. Okay, that's great. But what about some real things? What's some things that aren't easy? In fact, Becky and I were talking about this about a week ago. I said, you know, I wonder, coming into this new year, what if we actually went after the things that were hard? What if we actually went after the things that we've been putting on the back shelf, or the things that, how about this? How about things in your life and things in my life that you don't even have the want to yet, right? Because there's things in your life and mine that I don't want to ditch it. I want to hang on to it. And I need God's help for that. I'm talking about committed Christianity. The joke, I wrote it down because I fumbled it last time. It's like eggs and bacon for breakfast. The chicken is involved. The pig is committed, right? I'm talking about committed Christianity, all in, being intentional. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 8. Be well balanced and always alert, because your enemy, the devil, roams around incessantly like a roaring lion looking for its prey to devour. Take a decisive stand against him and resist his every attack with strong, vigorous faith. For you know that your believing brothers and sisters around the world are experiencing the same kind of troubles that you endure. Now, this is a tough verse for me because I don't think Americanized Christianity is enduring the struggles that many of our Christian brothers and sisters are in other places in the world. I'm not downplaying the challenges and struggles that we have, but in comparison, we have a Christianity that's pretty easy. And you know, I thank God for it. We don't have anybody outside wanting to shoot us because we're worshiping Jesus. But, you know, we're talking about being intentional, being aware, and we love the sowing and reaping so long as we're talking about the benefits, but, you know, you can't sow to things that are going to cause harm and not expect that the law of sowing and reaping doesn't come back, right? This is hard stuff. This is real stuff. This is rubber meets the road stuff. This is where I'm really believing for myself and my wife and our family and this church family that we will address the things that are hard in the coming year so that there's change that happens on the inside. Yes, we want to change the world. Yes, we're going to grow the community. Yes, we're going to continue to bring the gospel to the far stretches that we can and whatever God would allow us to do. But it has to begin with a message that works in us first. Amen? Tapping into God's amazing provision is going to require risk. It's going to require some challenges. It's not going to always be easy, but we are promised, Luke chapter 1, verse 37, for with God nothing will be impossible. There are so many of us that have no idea that that's true because we do everything that's possible in our own strength. But if we want to tap into really seeing what God can do in impossible situations, we're going to have to impose ourselves, get into risky things, to pull back the curtain and begin to deal with the things that we are ignoring. We have these promises that we can overcome them. It's God's grace, his ability on our lives. We are wrong if we think that grace is going to excuse us from the storm, excuse us from the trial. Paul, who is going through persecution and troubles and trials, he's calling out to God. We're going to look at this. Three times he asked the Lord to take him out of the struggle. And the response is the same response that I believe the Holy Spirit would say to you and to me. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse number 7, the Apostle Paul says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me." lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is what? Sufficient. My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I would rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ might rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and needs and persecutions and distress for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I'm strong. I used to struggle with the word choice here in the translations using the word sufficient. Because I don't know about you, but for me, when I think, oh, it's sufficient, it's almost like it's just enough. It has a scarcity, at least in my mind. It feels like, you know, well, at least you've got just enough. Well, it's a poor, maybe it means more than that to you, but to me, I thought, yeah, it's got to mean more than what I'm reading, and sure enough, it does. The Greek word is a profoundly powerful word, and it means, the Greek translation for sufficient, in possession of unfailing strength. That Paul was in possession. You and I, as Christians, as sons and daughters of God, filled with the Holy Spirit of God, we have this unfailing strength within us. Not to go around the struggle, not to avoid the struggle, not to hide the struggle, but to go through the struggle. And as I'm telling you this, I almost wish that I could have a reflection of myself, because this is where I'm at. This is where I'm living. Like, I want to tackle the hard things. I wanted the areas that I want to hold on to, that you're calling me out of, help me with the want to. I want to do the hard things. I want to press through the things that are dominating me, or things that are having control over me, or things that I need to take charge over. We waste this unfailing strength when we underutilize it. How? When we play it safe. I mean, when we go through this cutesy Christianity and we play it safe, then we really waste this unfailing strength. Recently, I had somebody say this statement to me. It's been bouncing around in my head, and I haven't been able to land on it because it didn't sit right with me. The statement sounds clever. He said to me, we find Jesus in the risk. We find Jesus in the risk. And I was kind of going through that back and forth, and I modified it, and I wonder if you'd agree with me. I wrote this down. We find Jesus in rest, and we find his faith in risk. We find Jesus in the rest, because I don't want it to sound like that we are now going back into works and everything that you do. However, don't kid yourself, and don't kid yourself, mister, that we don't have to risk or go out on a limb in our faith. That's where we actually find the measure of faith that I think Paul was talking about. Matthew chapter 11, verse number 28. Jesus says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The gospel of Jesus is not just an invitation or limited to an invitation of a future heaven. The gospel of Jesus is actually an invitation to a present possibility. A present possibility. Another trait that I see within Christianity and the Americanized church is that we are escape artists. We spend more time thinking about escaping this earth and going to heaven, or postponing things, putting off things, and we call it faith or waiting on God. No, if you do a search on waiting on God, usually the word translates to serve him, right? So this invitation is not just some ticket someday. It's the possibility of what we could do here on this earth, what we should be doing here on this earth. We're talking about real stuff. Now, let's give me a couple examples, because I think that when we talk about forgiveness, dropping the charges, letting things go, dealing with them, it's not easy, because forgiving people is a challenge. And Jesus was getting real with his disciples, and he began to tell them about this forgiveness thing. And I think this will hit the nail on the head for all of us, because forgiveness is hard. Look at Luke chapter 17. No matter, verse number 4, no matter how many times in one day your brother sins against you and says, I'm sorry, I'm changing, forgive me, you need to forgive him each and every time. Okay? Now, this was a hard pill for the disciples. Look what they said. Upon hearing this, the apostles said to Jesus, Lord, you're going to have to give us more faith. Brother's lacking, because I need some help, right? Jesus responded, if you even had the smallest measure of authentic faith it would be powerful enough to say to this large tree, my faith will put you up by the roots and throw you into the sea, and it will respond to your faith and obey. We need God's help. This is what I'm talking about, committed Christianity. Not the cutesy stuff, but the hard stuff. Many of us are carrying unforgiveness that it's time to let it go. It's time to forgive and drop the charges and not carry it into a brand new year. It'll just stink up the joint anyway. And it's crushing you from the inside. But forgiving people is hard because the majority of people don't make it easy. Right? They don't make it super easy to forgive them. It's hard, especially when you're trying to help somebody. A great example of this is in Acts chapter 28. The Apostle Paul has survived a shipwreck. Him and the other survivors make their way to the beach. Now on the beach with some of the locals that they're just met, they start a bonfire. And they're getting warm and they're kind of getting their wits about them again. And so Paul, wanting to help out everybody, walks over to the wood pile. And when he grabs a piece of wood to throw it on the fire, he gets bit by a snake, a viper. Sometimes you get bit when you're helping people. It's not always easy. They're not going out of their way to make it easy for you. And that's the most challenging when you're trying to do good, when you're trying to help somebody at your cost. Now, there's a great story I came across. This little girl named Mary Thiel from Metz, France. At 3 years of age, Marie received the bronze medal for an act of courage and dangerous sacrifice. 3 years old. But the one she rescued does not like her. When Marie's playmate, a two-year-old Dennis, fell into the municipal pool, she grabbed him by the hair and held his head up out of the water until her screams for help were answered. Marie told an interviewer later, he doesn't like me now because it hurt when I pulled his hair. You know, when you're trying to help somebody and they turn on you and they don't even like you, you know, I'm sorry about your hair, but you're alive, brother, right? So we're talking about things that are hard, and it is my aim to encourage. I've said this before. I want people to leave believers, a Sunday morning service, or any encounter that I have with people. I want them to feel like they're empowered, they're encouraged, that you can do it. In fact, I would even like it for people to be excited. But when we reserve excitement to an event, a church service, or an encounter, or a conference, the problem is excitement fades. But if you begin to bring execution to that excitement, it's like throwing a log on the fire. Every time that you make a step toward it, you address it, you pray about it, that you make some form of an action that God can make super. You see, we bring the natural, he brings the super, it becomes supernatural. So every time that you make a step towards that execution, you begin to keep that excitement, that fire going. I came up with this little analogy, or this little, equation. Excitement minus execution equals excuses. Because what happens when you're excited and you don't put some execution to it and you don't see the results, you start blaming. You start giving excuses. You start coming up with reasons why you have to wait till Monday, or you can't do this until this happens, or this changes. You see, we start making excuses. Having execution doesn't always have to be big, monumentous things. It can be subtle things that keeps that fire going, that keep you moving forward, so that in 2019, we're not people that are excuses or people full of excuses, but we're full of expectation because we've got execution that we are following up with and stirring ourselves up in the faith. Leo Tolstoy once said, everyone thinks of changing the world, but no one thinks of changing themselves. Because you have to go inward, and you got to be honest with yourself, and you got to pull back some things that are uncomfortable. This is hard stuff. This isn't the easy stuff. This is stuff that's going to either be dealt with by God's help, or you're going to carry it, and that burden will end up crushing us. But we need to take it on. We need to move forward toward it. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse number 10, the Apostle Paul says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow, that brings death. I love that the Apostle Paul makes a distinction here between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. Because sorrow alone never changed a person. Worldly sorrow, so far as I can tell, simply means you're just sorry that the outcome happened. You're not addressing why you did it in the first place. You're just sorry that you have to go through the painful consequences. And so it brings death. It doesn't bring change. But godly sorrow brings repentance, or leads to repentance. Repentance has been told by many well-meaning Christians and well-meaning pastors that it's the same thing as saying, I'm sorry. And that's not true. That's not what the word means at all. The word repent comes from the Greek word metanoia. It means to change your mind and change your direction. So godly sorrow, that the conviction, the angst on the inside, it leads us to a place of changing our thought, changing our direction, and it says it brings salvation. The word salvation here is the Greek word soteria, and it means to deliver. Okay, it's not talking about that in the end of your earth suit existence that now you're saved or it's an eternal thing. No, when you and I surrender to the godly sorrow, the pain that we're feeling, it leads us to change our mind, and from that point, we find deliverance. There's areas in your life, there's areas in my life that it's time to get delivered from. Somebody say amen. It's time to get delivered from. The purpose of pain is to move us into action, not make us suffer. Pain is actually a gift. It tells you not to do that again. And pain is there to cause you to respond and get out of it, to change it. I've heard it said so many times, and it seems to be catching on even among Christians. Oh, just do what makes you happy. Wrong. Terrible advice. Don't just, happy? Are you kidding me? Happy is based on happenings. So do what makes you happy. No, do what makes you great. In 2019, let's make that our motto. Don't just do what makes you happy. Do what makes you great. And according to Jesus, not only is it encouraged, it's something that he expects. That he expects of you and I to pursue greatness. How do we get there? Matthew chapter 18, verse number 1. At that time, the disciples came to ask Jesus, who is considered to be the greatest in heaven's kingdom realm? And Jesus called a little one to his side and said to them, learn this well. Unless you dramatically change your way of thinking and become teachable and learn about heaven's kingdom realm with wide-eyed wonder of a child, you will never be able to enter it. Whoever continually humbles himself to become like this gentle child is the greatest one in heaven's kingdom realm. Humility leads to greatness. The Apostle Peter says it this way, 1 Peter 5, verse number 6. If you bow low in God's awesome presence, he will eventually exalt you as you leave the timing in his hands. He goes on to say in verse 7, pour out all your worries and stress upon him and leave them there, for he always is tenderly cares for you. So it's the hard stuff, like forgiving, the stuff that you can't do on your own. It's the intentional pursuit of greatness, and by greatness, it's being humble. And humble also does mean that you acknowledge who you are in Jesus, and to live less than that is a violation of your identity anyway. I want to know what he says about me, and I want to believe what he says about me more than what I think about myself. Another good opportunity for you to amen. Y'all making me work for this one. Finally, as I begin to bring it in for a landing, I'm not closing yet, but as I bring it in for a landing, we got to stop blaming. Let's make 2019 a year that we no longer blame. When you blame, you forfeit power. You instantaneously put yourself in a mindset of being a victim. It stalls you. It stops you. Nothing stops you in your tracks faster than blaming. Danny Silk says, blame is projecting out responsibility rather than acknowledging that responsibility starts with you. Responsibility starts with us. We got to stop casting or projecting the blame on someone else. I mean, it's getting pathetic, really. My mommy put me on a cold toilet when I was 2. That's why I can't keep a job. Stop it. Stop it. Got to stop blaming. Take responsibility. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse number 19. This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I set before you life and death. You see, he's giving them the option. I'm giving you, through Moses's God speaking through Moses, I'm giving you the choice between life and death, blessing and cursings. And then he gives them the right answer. He says, guys, choose life. Right? Choose life that you and your children may live. The Apostle Paul begins to write about the internal challenge, the conflict that we all deal with. Romans chapter 8, verse number 5. Those who are motivated by the flesh. Now, the word flesh is just your senses, what makes you happy, what you think about, how you feel. It's all just carnal, natural. It's not the spiritual side of us. It's just the drives and the passions that we have as a human. It says, those who are motivated by the flesh only pursue what benefits themselves. But those who live by the impulses of the Holy Spirit are motivated to pursue spiritual realities. For the mindset of the flesh is death, but the mindset controlled by the Spirit finds life and peace. In fact, the mindset focused on the flesh fights God's plan and refuses to submit to his direction because it cannot. For no matter how hard they try, God finds no pleasure with those who are controlled by the flesh. But when the Spirit of Christ empowers your life, you are not dominated by the flesh, but by the Spirit. I want to be dominated and led and empowered by the Spirit of God more than ever. And if you are not joined to the Spirit of the Anointed One, you are not of him. Let's go back two chapters, same book, Romans chapter 6, verse number 15, speaking about the challenge of sin and the temptations that we all deal with. What are we to do then, he says in verse number 15? Should we sin till our hearts are content, since there's no law to condemn us anymore? What a terrible thought. Don't you realize that grace frees you to choose your own master? You see, we take accountability and responsibility by choosing. It's a beautiful choice. It's a beautiful thing that he gives us. It gives great honor. He honors you and I by allowing us to choose what path we'll take. But choose carefully, for you surrender yourself to become a servant, bound to the one you choose to obey. If you choose to love sin, it will become your master, and it will own you and reward you with death. But if you choose to love and obey God, he will lead you into perfect righteousness. May 2019 not only be filled with all of the great dreams and visions and plans that many people want for their lives, and that's not wrong. You should believe God for increase in your finances. You should believe God for a healthier life in 2019. You should believe for your children to become more and more rooted in the things of God and your grandchildren and your legacy. We should be believing to expand. Hang on to the words like, let's go change the world. But changing the world starts with a changed heart, a committed heart, because we can choose life and death each day, blessing and cursing each day. In order to keep the fire going, the excitement going, we're going to have to execute each day. That means in the morning when I'm not feeling it, in the afternoon when I'm not feeling it, when I'm mad at somebody and I need to drop the charges for what seems to be the 100th time today, I need God's help. I got to stop casting the blame on someone else or something else or the challenges of life, because you know what we all have in common? Challenges of life. But we also, for those of us that are in Christ, we are empowered by his Spirit, and his grace is sufficient and unfailing strength. Now, this is good preaching. I know, I'm encouraging myself. But it means nothing if we don't actually do something with it. Myself included, what we do when we walk out this door will determine the course of 2019, 2020, however we want to look out. But let's use this moment as, for some of us, a course correction. Let's just make the change. Let's dive in. Some, we need to just say, for the first time, I'm going to trust him with everything. That I need salvation. I need deliverance. I need salvation sozo. I need to be made whole. The reason I'm doing these things, or I'm allowing these activities, or inviting these things into my life, is because there's missing something in me. And God wants to heal those areas. He wants to touch those areas. And he wants to bring us into a place that looks more and more like freedom. Amen? Amen. Would you stand with me? I'd like to pray over you. Everyone, just put your hand on your heart. Father, I pray right now, not just a typical closing message prayer. I pray that you would help us to yield. Give you right away. Father, I thank you that our lives change at the speed of our decisions. And so in this moment, Lord, I pray that there would be a radical shift within our thinking, repentance, changing direction, changing our mind, that our mindset would be locked in, not to the sensualities and the flesh part of us, but that our mindset would be locked into the empowering Spirit that leads us to victory after victory, deliverance after deliverance. I thank you, Lord, for a work in us that is greater than the work outside of us. God, that there'd be a profound moment of shifting within us personally, within our households, within our businesses, and within this church. I believe that you have great things in store for each household, every family, and this community. Lord, help us to stay committed to do the hard part. God, to lean in on faith more than just things that bring comfort, but to address the things that are hard, even the things that we don't want to address. Help us with the want to. I pray all of this. If you agree, in Jesus' name, say amen.